We're almost there. Okay. Hey, folks. Thanks for tuning into the BAMP podcast. Today is our increasingly irregular Wednesday writer series happening on a Thursday because it's increasingly irregular. Ryan Danks could make it today because he's having car stuff. But here we are with JR Hanley. How you doing, JR?
Doing outstanding. And yourself?
Living the life. And below me is Walt Rebilliard. How you doing, Walt?
I love the sound of, what is it? The sound of deadlines as they fly by.
And Walt is having a podcasting extravaganza today. Just got off the air with Nick Cole a few minutes ago.
Yeah,
we were a man of perpetual podcasts, our Walt.
Yes. Yeah, Nick wanted to talk about the hate mail we just got from Stanford University. So, yeah, that was fun.
All right, that sounds really interesting, but maybe that's a conversation for off the air.
For another time.
Because at Writer's Chat, we try to talk about writing stuff, not just hate mail. And Walt suggested topic for today was don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good. What do you mean by that, Walt?
So, you know, this is a term going all the way back to, hey-o, Josh Hayes. Oh, God, I love that guy.
Where are your dolls, Josh? Do they approve of that?
You know, this is why we don't have friends. Because you start saying stuff like that. They're action figures. I got your back, Josh. So in the Army, you always have that guy that's got the best sayings on the planet. You know, they're the stuff that's memorable. They help you learn. And they kind of collectibles. See? I got you, Josh. Right? And not only do they help you, learn, but they kind of stick with you no matter what you do. And when we were learning as a private in the unit I was in, we would learn to write operations orders, which are these massive, huge documents you have to submit when your unit is going to do an operation en masse. So we would learn that as a private. And, you know, you'd agonize it because you didn't want your sergeant to come back and slap you in the back of the ear and be like, dude, hurry up. Let's go. Come on. It's got to be good. You know, and we just had this one guy and he was always like, hey, never let perfect be the enemy of good. We got to get it out there today. And if we got to launch a plan, you know, say the enemy isn't exactly where we need them to be. But if we don't do it right now, we're going to miss our window, even though it's not perfect. Don't let perfect be the enemy of good. You know, because a good plan executed violently now trumps a perfect plan that might happen later, you know, and that's all Army doctrine that, you know, kind of seeps into your writing. And you can look at it the same way, because you can have a manuscript that you've dropped down and you've pored over this thing. You've hired an editor, you've hired a content editor and a developmental editor, and you get it back and their suggestions don't jive with what you did kind of really wanted. So you start picking the story apart and, you know, kind of trying to mold it like it's clay, and then you send it back to the editors again, and they really don't like your changes, so you know you take it back. All these times that you're making all these changes, trying to carve away the little bits to make the perfect statue of the David, you know, in the European Museum, or you know, get that last brush stroke on the Mona Lisa. Meanwhile, these other 40 dudes, they just dropped an epic butt ton of books and they're making loot. So you and your highfalutin can sit there and, you know, edit the fourth word in the third paragraph of the 35th page for the 19th time. You know, get your manuscript out there, write it down, get it edited. If you got to make changes, make some changes and then put it out there, you know, because let's face it. None of us are Hemingway.
I use a lot of periods.
Yeah,
that scrolls to the advice most authors get in the beginning is just write because you can't edit a blank page. And a little known secret about what most is literature now, it wasn't when it was written. It was the pulp of the era, whatever that was good enough people remembered it. So they would have their friends read it and it survived. So if you want to be the next Hemingway, start by being the James Patterson of your generation.
Yeah. You know, and I mean, if you look at that book, you know, like for example, Old Man and the Sea, my favorite book of all time. I read it at least once every couple of years, right? I love the idea of no limits because you don't impose them on yourself, you know? And I love that book, but it's something like 140 pages or something like that. There's nothing to it. It's just a simple story about a guy who went fishing, you know, but it's such a powerful message, multiple powerful messages in that book. I love it, you know, and at the time it was, you know, like JR was saying, it was could have probably bought it for 15 cents, you know, just if, but the thing is, if you're hoarding over your words, like, malfeasant isn't really the word I want to use. There's got to be a synonym for that that I can throw in there. It's like, listen, 1920s radio producer, first of all, you need to calm down. Second of all, write asshole and then truck on with the rest of your manuscript. You know what I mean?
And if you ask people, like, some of the most influential books for them, most of the time, it's not like Jane Eyre or Hemingway. It's something they read as a kid. So I could tell you off the top of my head, Across Five Aprils, Johnny Tremain, Rifles for Waiting. Those books made an impact on me. They're not written high prose. Look at Tom Clancy's book. He's not written high prose. People read those books over and over again. Yep. And decades after the Cold War ended, when they were written, they're modernizing them so they can put them on TV again.
Yeah. You know? And although I like John Krasinski, I thought he played a nice Jack Ryan. That second season just sucked egg rolls. Oh my God, was it terrible!
Amazon has a problem with second seasons.
Whew.
I've gotten in a few Amazon shows. Season one's great. You're excited. Season two, what the fuck happened here?
Yeah. You know who else has a problem with second seasons? Freaking Fox, who cancels them. I'm looking at you, Terra Nova. I'm looking at you, Firefly.
Okay, so Terra Nova was like 10 years ago and Firefly was 15 or 20. We need to get you some new hobbies, bro.
I'm not over it. They were awesome. We had dinosaurs, freaking dinosaurs in time space continuums, all right?
Yep. Yep.
I think Firefly at this point might be better off. You know, it was nice. It's kind of poetic. Everyone wanted more. You didn't get what you wanted. But at this point, I don't know how you would even revisit that shit. Unless you did like animated or something.
Yeah, it's like 20 years later. I mean, unless you're talking about like the kids took over the ship, you know?
Well, they're doing a comic book that has it happen.
Yes, he was great in 13 Hours. John Krasinski. Yeah, he played, what's that guy's name? He's got that awesome AR build that he always flaunts online. Anyway, gun porn stuff. But yeah, don't take so long at a manuscript that you're going to miss out on other opportunities just because you're agonizing over every word. Because, you know, I read usually two books a week. I'm getting a book on audio, usually either just read by my phone or on Audible or something like that. And then I have my Kindle usually close by with stuff loaded onto it. So I can read, you know, whenever I get a few minutes. And I just devour anything I can get my hands on. In the last 5 years, I've gone down to about 3 hours of television that I watch with my wife during the week. And the rest of my free time, you know, as copious as it is, goes to reading, because I would rather read. I'm getting much better content. I'm getting more involved stories. So as a voracious reader, if I got an author that I really like and he's not putting out content, I'm going to move on to somebody else. But beside that, a lot of times I'm reading so quickly, or like if I'm listening to something on audio, those 14 words in that one paragraph that you were agonizing over for like 3 days, you didn't sleep a lot, you were barely eating because, you know, malfeasant just didn't work for the sentence that you were going for, you know, and then finally you figured it out and you got everything working the way you wanted to and you put it down on the page. There could be a very real possibility that that paragraph you agonized over for 3 days, I might have to skip or I might not ignore entirely because of the fact that I was chasing my dog from trying to run up a tree.
Yeah, I think part of it is just the mindset, right? I mean, and there's a million different ways of going at that. But if you're thinking, I want to write a story, get in the world so I get feedback, so I can improve it, so I can get people who like to read my stuff, that's a lot different than I'm going to make this a perfect bonsai tree of a story, put it in my suitcase upstairs. Maybe after I die, my grandkids will find it and read it.
Yeah. I mean, get it out there. Absolutely.
Don't use malfeasance. Use misfeasance. Different words, similar. They're yeah. You'll like it. Your editor will love you for it.
I remember an interaction on Twitter with John Scalzi and one of his legion of followers, where she was talking about how really writing is all about getting into someone else's head, and empathizing with another human being, and really understanding who they are and how they see things. And Scalzi, I think he was joking, but I'm never 100% sure. He was like, "Nah, writing's about paying my goddamn mortgage. What are you talking about?" And true. The thing is, they're both right.
Yeah.
But you know, it's art can serve a lot of, art can be something you just do by yourself. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, JR.
I just say that along that lines, like sometimes we don't realize as writers that once we tell the story in our head, like every reader is going to interpret it differently. So once you put it into the wild, if you know, in your head, I don't know, Dumbledore really was a closet were panda. If you didn't tell us that, then he wasn't. He might be to you, but it's not canon. So whatever happens. Yeah, whatever happens. I didn't want to say what they said with the J.K. Rowling. I'm trying to keep this apolitical.
Hey, but, fair enough.
But so whatever you wrote down is canon. Everything else is headcanon of everybody that read it, and it will all be different. So, you know, maybe he had a drunken father who beat him. You didn't say that, but that's how Bob over in corner B took it. Well, that's true for him. And so when you write, you have to realize that you don't own it once you publish it. And so when you try to write, sometimes like you're adding too much angst to yourself for no good reason. Like it's because they're going to take it with their own baggage involved. And then just to sort of piggyback off what Walt said, you said write as fast as you can. Obviously, that's different for everybody. Walt writes three times as many words a day as I do. My broken noggin can only do so much. So you have to be realistic with yourself.
Yeah.
But still scale the advice. So it's still good to say, you know, don't go crazy, right? But if for you fast is 500 words a day, then rock on. At the end of the year, you got a novel.
Yeah. And I mean, we've heard guys on Keystroke Medium like Josh and Scott. Scott the other day was talking about, he had a week where on one day he had 7 words. That's all he was able to type that one day, you know, but it was a good day because he still got some words on there, you know? So yeah, don't feel like, you're not adding to the pile because of the fact that, you know, you only got X number of words for one day or whatever. But at the same time, you know, don't look at that one paragraph and agonize over it for so long that you're missing out on all the other writing you could be doing. There's just great potential to get so many story ideas out there. And the thing is, if you look at that paragraph and be like, yeah, fine, I'll tackle it later. Oh God, dog, really? but if you look at that paragraph and say, I'll tackle it later, a lot of times as you're writing, you could come up with something that says that helps you fix that paragraph you were having a problem with.
Or that makes that paragraph irrelevant.
Yep. And then you can ditch it.
So I will say that, you know, the days where you just get 7 words for me with my head injury, like you tend to get migraines with traumatic brain injury a lot, enough that the pain centers register on an MRE. And so sometimes like just one word, like that's me not giving up. Right. And so like, there's nothing wrong with that 7 word. And the other thing that I do for myself that might work for you if you ever get down is sometimes when you're editing, things are slower. You're not getting a bunch of crazy new words, which is like, that's a high that you get. I got 12,000 words today or whatever. Like I get it. We've all been there. So what I do is I track it differently, but I say, okay, I know if I'm in a role, I can write 500 words an hour. So when I have an hour of doing editing, every hour that's editing, I count that as 500 words so I can track it. And then when you look at it that way, because it's tangible, you're like, oh, okay. So I wasn't an unproductive cranker today. I spent X number of hours editing and that had value too. But one way to cut yourself out of those editing pitfalls that you talked about, I actually, you can do this on Word. I don't know what Mac does, but basically I have the computer read it out loud to me.
Yeah.
And most of the time what you'll find is those turn of phrases. Like when someone actually tries to read it or say it out loud, like your audiobook narrator, don't make them hate you. Like most, most of those turns of phrases, they're like, you son of a bitch. Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cuss, but it's like, sometimes you can just get a little too cheeky for your own good.
Yep. You ain't lying.
Yeah. That was the best editing advice I ever got back in my journalist days was read your stuff outline. Now it's, there's a saying in journalism. I didn't have time to write it short, so I wrote it long because it's, you know, editing takes time. You get down to a perfect little piece of writing, but if you don't have that, yeah, you write things long. But yeah, saying it out loud, because that's what the reader's going to do in their head. And if it's clunky, that's what they're going to trip over it. So.
And then along those lines is don't write names that have so many apostrophes. Nobody knows what the heck that is, because that means that it makes it harder for the reader to stick it in their head. Like, I know you want to add flavor and whatever, but you get to the point where it gets ridiculous. And you're not helping anyone. You're not cool because you put that 12th apostrophe.
Yeah, no, nobody's remembering Zenta Habadamana, but you know what they are remembering? The Dread Pirate Roberts.
Yeah. And so, like, when I do mine, when the narrator says, is this how you pronounce any of these words? Like, give me a pronunciation guide. And I'm like, I wrote it down. If you want to say wyvern instead of wyvern or whatever, like, I'm cool with it. Whatever.
Right on.
The only thing that matters is words that, like, oh, this happened to a book I like. Instead of adjutant, it was adjutant.
Oh.
And instead of the unit was routed, they were rooted. I'm like, wait, is it a tree or are they running? So like,
you, they were rooted. Like, did you call a plumber?
But those are, or corpsmen instead of corpsmen. Like, those are the kind of things people care about. Yeah. Like, but for the rest of it, I'm like, what? Like, however you picture it in your head, buddy, rock on.
Oof.
You know, kind of a funny thing, in the Game of Thrones audiobooks, there's so much time between the books, even when several of the earlier books had the same narrator, but you know, it's like 5 years between volumes and he forgot. So he would change accents from characters from, you know, one book to the next.
That's awesome.
God love George Martin. He's taking his time with those motherfuckers. But
it's funny too. Cause like, speaking of corpsmen, I was listening to Forget Nothing and I had read the book twice before it ever came out on Audible as an Audible original. And, you know, I'd read the Galaxy's Edge series a bunch of times and stuff like that, but I had never listened to any Galaxy's Edge on audio. So I was like, oh, it's an Audible original. I'll pick it up and I'll just listen to it for once, you know, something in between books. And I was just like, I got online and I got on the fan group and I'm like, huh, who knew Owens was Scottish? I was like this main character in the series and never once did I pick up from reading it. Josh, that's awesome.
Yeah, hey, is that right?
That's awesome. But yeah, and the narrator is dead. They're going to have to find someone new for 6 and 7 if they ever get written.
That's yeah, but true.
Aren't they going to let Sanderson write it because, you know, he can write like 5,000 words a day.
I someone's got a machine learning program somewhere that could crank out these last two books, but they're just waiting for George to have a stroke or something.
Can't we just feed all of his books to an AI and have the AI write it?
That AI is called Terry Goodkind, and yes, we can. But, that was mean to Terry. I'm sorry. You write some good books, I'm sure. But
I like Alder agrees.
Yeah.
Goodkind did the Sword of Truth series.
He did, yeah. And the Spatula of Shannara. Is that him?
No, Shannara was Pratchett, right?
No, Pratchett was Discworld.
There's so many dang Terrys out there writing books. It gets confusing.
Terry Brooks was Shannara. I was wrong. I was thinking Terry Pratchett, there's a lot of Terrys. You're right. So many damn Terrys.
And this is why Walt can't let his friend Terry Shepard write a book. There's just too many damn Terrys.
Oh, my God. That would be hysterical. Could you picture that?
I could see him as a narrator for some books.
Oh, my God. He's got that gravelly voice, too, where he'd be really good. Do you know who that is, Mike? Terry Shepard?
I do not know.
He's my favorite snake eater.
He is a former member of the United States Army Special Forces who goes on to things like the Discovery Channel and hosts a bunch of shit like Shark Week.
Oh.
And he's like, yeah, so I'm going to get in this cage and I'm going to swim with great whites because they're paying me to. And this is going to be fantastic. And he's like petting the sharks as they're going by. He's, oh, look, he tried to bite me. That's awesome. fuck that shark.
You know, well, that's a guy you can ghostwrite for.
No, wait, no, stop. I don't need any more projects right now.
You think William Shatner wrote all those Tech War novels?
No.
So, Walt, do you want me to tell you people I know looking for narrators?
Don't you start, right? Because ever since the pandemic happened, right, I can't even get people some of the things I owe them because of like things setting off the dog and blah 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 because everybody's home. So there's so much noise and there's only so much soundproofing I can throw in my office. But yeah, definitely. Let's I'm going to use my blunt force segue, which in my office is called a kukri knife, and I'm going to circle us back around to the topic at hand. Mike, what are some of the things that you do, like when you're producing stuff for Fanning Goat Games? Mm-hmm. What do you do when you hit that like snag, like you're like, no, I got to make this perfect? How do you get away from that?
Oh, hey, someone else like Tech War. All right. The best thing is to do another project. And if I'm getting sick of, you know, if I'm stuck in editing, trying to get it right, then go do something more creative or do something completely unrelated in a whole other field, you know, computers or whatever, you know, else my thing might be. Sometimes I can power through it if I alter my state of mind by drinking lots of coffee, you know, where you just get the effort mentality. I'm just going to push through it and just, you know, going to get this done. Or you can drink other things that might get to that place too. But, you know, diminishing returns as you get older on some of that. So,
you know, our friends over at Keystroke Medium have their own coffee.
I heard they did. Yes.
It's very tasty. In fact,
I'm working on getting a powdered juice beverage for BAMP. But we're still in negotiations on that.
I can't wait to get the snack cakes, though. We need the snack cakes.
So the one thing I can tell you as someone, because of my migraines and my head injuries, that sometimes when you're just plowing through, when you go back on the second or third draft, you can't tell the difference on the day that we're like, man, this is the most awesome thing ever. I'm so glad I'm a writer. And fuck, this just gave me one more word so I can go to bed. And so that's the good thing about editing. You'll never be able to tell later.
Yeah. It's, I would completely agree. I mean, I get stuck on projects. I mean, you know, Walt, I've been working on that book for you very slowly for 2 years now. But,
I don't judge.
No, it's, I mean, I've broken through the last couple of days or last couple of weeks. I think it might just because I've been working on some other things, got away from it. And you come back, it's kind of like, you know, somebody seems like a real badass, you know, 1 year in high school and you come back after your growth spurt and you're like, why was I scared of this guy? What am I even worried about? It's so the obstacle that seems that's such a big deal. The next day, you know, you get some distance, doesn't seem that bad. So anyway, to sum things up, basically just effing right. Don't get, you know what? I'm doing this really badly. Handing the mic off you to JR. Can you see what we've been talking about?
So, just right. You can't edit a blank page and rock on.
Yeah. That's like, Inigo Montoya, in The Princess Bride, because we just talked about the Dread Pirate Roberts. It's like, okay, let me explain. No, this is too much. Let me sum up. Love that.
You keep saying that word. I don't think that word means what you think it means. I don't think
that word means what you think it means.
If you had a chance, that book was pretty great too.
Yeah, the book was really, really good. And then, of course, the movie, they did such a great job because everybody did like their stuff so flat. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, oh, you should also know, I'm not left-handed either. You know, and it's no overpouring of emotion, no overpouring of melodrama. It was just right. You know, except for Vizzini, the Sicilian.
I will say that I really dug the Andre the Giant.
Yes.
Proving that you can get a wrestler that can actually act, looking at you, Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Arnold does the best he can. He wasn't a bad governor of California. They might wish he had to hit him back right now. So.
Yeah, with the problems they're having.
Yeah. At least it's not Texas, but poor Oof. Texas.
Yeah.
All right. So, hey, that's wrapping things up. We're going to try to do this again next Wednesday on the BAMF podcast. And we've got an email list I swear we'll be promoting next time with stories that we're working on so you can get behind the scenes, see how the sausage is made. And till then, we'll catch you next time on the BAMF podcast.
Try the borscht.
Oh, God.
Try the borscht.